All right, good to have your company this Friday morning. Let's get the very latest news, and it's all about the weather, Tom.
Certainly is, Georgie. The fire is in a number of states, a push to the limit at the moment. An early start to the bushfire season across our east coast. Blazes are right now burning in both New South Wales and Queensland. Extreme fire danger warnings are in place. We have full coverage this morning of the conditions in both states. We'll go first to Nine reporter Grace Fitzgibbon, who's on the fire ground in Foster. Grace, what's in store there today?
Good morning, Tom. Well, as you mentioned, there are right now 69 fires still burning across the state, and five of those are right here on the mid-north coast. But the good news is that they were downgraded just before midnight last night as fire crews worked around the clock to gain the upper hand. Tensions were very high, though, yesterday in Hillview, where we saw flames come dangerously close to homes there. Reports this morning that a number of structures have been damaged or destroyed. There was a second fire on Goldens Road in Forster, and that grew around 9 hectares yesterday. Breaking containment lines, a real headache for fire crews there, but that too is now under control. A stern warning for residents here from the RFS that a fire ban is still in place for the whole of northeastern New South Wales today. We are expecting hotter and drier conditions, even more extreme than yesterday. So no reprieve there for fire crews battling these blazes today. The message for residents here is to continue to monitor the conditions and, of course, have a plan in place, Tom.
All right, Grace, thank you. I want to take you now to today's Sydney reporter, Sarah Stewart, who is at RFS headquarters for us. Sarah, a real fire danger across a number of parts of the state.
Yeah, that's right, Tom. It's going to be extremely dangerous right across the state today. The far northeast is where we're going to see those really extreme conditions, and residents should be on high alert. But we are being told that the fires are coming down, and many of them are joining. There are 69 fires at the moment. Over half of them, I've just been told, are still not contained. The wind is going to pick up at around 1 o'clock this afternoon. We'll then have 6 hours, which is considered a real danger period, to around 7 o'clock. After that, the conditions should ease. Overnight will become cooler, the wind will ease. It'll still be windy tomorrow, however, so hopefully over the weekend they can get the upper hand, because I've just been told that come Monday or Tuesday we can also expect another danger period. Tom?
All right, Sarah, thank you. Let's go now to Jess Millward, who is in Queensland at Boona and following the fire threat in that state. Jess, a number of fire threats.
That's right, Tom. Around 30 bushfires burning across the state of Queensland this morning, the most concerning of which is one at Clumber. It's burning in bushland not too far away from where we are this morning in Boona. It sits at prepare to leave warning levels, so residents are being asked to stay across the warnings throughout today. Fire crews have been doing the very best they can to get on top of that blaze. Before the conditions deteriorate today, we're going to see fire dangers of extreme for the South Coast region, the Darling Downs and the Granite Belt region. Very warm temperatures, 37 for the city in Brisbane, 39 for Ipswich, a return of the strong winds that we saw earlier in the week, and very low humidity. All of those things combining have fire crews very worried as to what we could see today. They warn that it won't take much for a fire to start, and it could be very hard to contain those blazes. We do have extra resources on standby, including water bombing aircraft. Tomorrow, the fire danger will dip down slightly, but it will still sit at very high for the coming days, and unfortunately, Tom, no rain on the forecast.
Jess, Sarah and Grace there with that comprehensive coverage. Thank you.
Well, it is a stark contrast in southern parts of the country, with an Antarctic blast bringing cold temperatures, rain, gusty winds, even hail across Victoria. Let's go to Isabella Stashkovsky in Melbourne. And Isabella, just how long are these conditions expected to last?
Georgie, this morning it wasn't so bad, but the conditions have seriously become rotten. It started raining, it's getting windy, and it's expected to last for about 2 days. On Sunday, it'll get a little bit warmer, about 18 degrees, and then on Monday, somehow 26. Now, today and tomorrow, it's not going to get much warmer than 14 degrees. And a wintry blast like that at this time of year, we haven't seen that since 2007. So people heading to Stakes Day on Saturday, maybe pack a jumper or something, because it is going to be seriously cold. Now, there is rain and hail predicted across the state. Unfortunately, that won't be reaching drought-affected areas, but alpine regions could even see some snow, lower-lying areas like Mount Baw-Baw have already seen some in the past few days, Georgie. But, you know, despite these awful conditions, quite frankly, we have still seen these rowers out and about braving these conditions in some little shorts. We've got some just behind us now too. I don't know how they're doing it because I'm wearing thermals. Back to you,
Georgie.
Stay
warm. Thanks, Isabella.
The bosses of the Commonwealth Bank and Westpac will get a grilling today when they face a federal parliamentary inquiry. Nine's Fiona Willen is in Canberra for more on this. For the politicians, they want to know why the banks aren't passing on cuts to official interest rates.
Deb, I suspect a lot of people would like to know the answer to that question. Two of the big four are back in the spotlight today. Westpac and CBA, the bosses, will be facing questions from federal politicians in a parliamentary committee. Now, we understand they'll be asked to demonstrate how they're fixing their culture following those damning findings of the Banking Royal Commission. The inquiry found there was a culture of greed with banks pursuing short-term profits at the expense of customers. Now, Liberal MP Tim Wilson is chairing the committee. He says he'll demand to know why the Reserve Bank's three recent interest rate cuts were not passed on in full to borrowers, and also what impact low interest rates are having on the banks. ANZ and NAB are due to face a similar grilling here next week. Deb.
Fee Willen in Canberra, thank you.
The Liberal Party last night farewelled former Prime Minister Tony Abbott with the special tribute dinner in Sydney. It was emceed by broadcaster Alan Jones and included the Prime Minister Scott Morrison, former PM John Howard and New South Wales Premier Gladys Berejiklian, with Mr Abbott revealing he's now come to terms with his loss at the most recent election.
If anyone wants to know who is to blame for the Warringah result, it was not the campaign. It was just the candidate. They wanted to put some things in the past.
Tony Abbott's wife, Margie, was unable to attend. She's recovering from a health problem.
The Duke and Duchess of Sussex are celebrating a milestone, revealing baby Archie has his first two teeth. Our Europe correspondent, Amelia Adams, joins us from outside Buckingham Palace to elaborate on the news. Amelia, the couple, well, they're quite candid about Archie while chatting to a group of children. What more can you tell us?
Well, they were, Georgie, and given how secretive and protective they are of Archie, their fans were really excited by this. They were visiting military families just outside of Windsor when Meghan let slip. She was talking to one of the little girls when she said this. Take a listen.
Yes! Look at all your little teeth. Archie just got two teeth. It's a tiny one right there.
So two teeth, and she also apparently told one of the mums that Archie, at the age of 6 months, has just started crawling, which is pretty impressive. She's obviously a very proud mother, and having a teething baby certainly not slowing them down, because Harry and Meghan were on to a much more solemn event for Remembrance Week, taking part in a service at Westminster Abbey's Remembrance Field of Remembrance, meeting with some war veterans and chatting with them, as well as laying a poppy and a cross at that service. And they do have a very busy weekend ahead of them, Georgie, with several Remembrance Day services here across London, with the rest of the royal family and the Queen as well.
Plenty of royal news, and you're right across it, Amelia Adams. Thank you very much for that.
All right, it's a big week ahead in sport. Let's check in with Tony Jones, who's got all the latest from Sandown Raceway in Melbourne.
Yes, we certainly have hit the pits at the moment, Tom. We're at the team garage of Team LeBrock and Webb, and their car looking absolutely sensational. That will be one of many in action right across the next 3 days, starting today with official practice here at Sandown. The big one, of course, the 500 on Sunday. But let's turn our attention to tennis, specifically in the West, where Australia's Fed Cup team history beckons for the ladies, because we haven't won that title in 45 years. Captain Alicia Molik says she has settled on just who will take the court in Perth.
Yeah, we have done our research. We're very familiar with their best few and the way that they play singles, their best doubles combination also. So it's finding the right matchup, I think, for the conditions on the weekend. It's going to be very hot.
Last night, Australia hosted France at the traditional Fed Cup dinner. Still in Perth, it's all happening there at the moment. The Australian cricketers have cooled off from their red-hot start to the T20 series, riding the wave of momentum. Australia go into tonight's third match, leading 1-0. With Pat Cummins rested, Langer will likely choose between Billy Stanlake or Sean Abbott. In the NRL, Parramatta has announced they've signed the services of Ryan Madison for the next 3 years. The back rower will finally move clubs after a long, long process of trying trying to leave West Tigers for a better deal. Parramatta head back to the training paddock later this month. They're already training in the AFL at St Kilda, and young ruckman Rowan Marshall is pretty excited that he's going to get to learn from one of the game's best this pre-season. Paddy Ryder is one of five new Saints, and Marshall believes there's no one better to help out in ruck duties. You'd have to say there's a pretty good feeling around Moorabbin these days after positive signs at the back end of last season with new coach Brett Ratton. They're also pretty active at the trade table over the recent trade period. All right, that's the latest in sport from Sandown. We'll be back here a little later on with a special guest. In the meantime, though, let's check in with the weather because it is wide and varied across this great country of ours, Stevie.
It is indeed. Thank you, TJ. And it's a hot day here in Sydney, and it's going to be a warm weekend. So we've come out to Raging Waters in Western Sydney. We're going to be checking out some of the big thrill rides that they've got here. They've got something for the whole family, but this is the area where no guts, no glory. We're going to send a few kids down now and find out what happens. But while we do that, let's go to the skies and find out what's happening at your place with the weather today. With sunshine expected right down the coast of Queensland, hot for Brisbane, a top of 37 degrees, windy in the Gold Coast, 32 in Sydney, becoming windy, a very warm top of 30 degrees today. Canberra showers and wind 18. Local hail and thunder expected in Melbourne with showers and 14. 14 the top for Hobart today with some wet weather on the way, and Adelaide morning showers and 18. Very hot conditions in the west, Perth on 35, Broome on 41, Darwin on 34 degrees. Okay, I can just start to hear the screams now as some of the kids are coming down these thrill rides. You've got the Bombora on the left. Now that is the blue ride where you kind of splash down, lose your weight into a big wave-shaped funnel. In the middle, you got the Tantrum. Three funnels, 7 metres wide, side by side, with all these kind of flume bowl areas that connect the tunnels. And then on the right-hand side, the green and yellow, that's what you call the T5, where riders drop down into an 18-metre wide funnel. That shoots you back and forth. And all of these rides, there comes one now, drop down into this splash pool on these four-people, four-leaf clover little tubes.